Refillers, I'm Jake Adams. I know it's been a little while since you've had a new video from me, but you can count that I'm not gonna let more than 2 weeks go by before another video is uploaded. So for this video topic, I figured I'd come at you with something, a really important question that I get a lot of times in the comments is how to quarantine fish. And quarantining saltwater fish is an interesting practice, and it's really something that everyone should do, because a quarantine tank should never really be mixed up with other fish. And as you know, the saltwater stores that try to quarantine, they're always getting shipments coming and going. It's really important to quarantine your fish, even if they come from a place that's been quarantined. So what is a quarantine tank? For me, quarantining is less about really treating and dealing with parasites than it is about acclimating and conditioning the fish to the saltwater aquarium environment. These fish coming from the ocean have the entire world basically to swim around, and have very specific foods and specific environments that they come from. And so, you know, it takes them a little bit of time to adjust to aquarium life. And once you get them eating and healthy and settled in, their immune system can really handle a lot of the potential parasites that might threaten their health and their survivability in an aquarium. So what do you need to have a basic quarantine aquarium? What I really like about quarantine tank is that it strips down everything about a saltwater tank to its bare essentials. And in some ways, setting up a quarantine tank is almost like great practice at just setting up as a basic saltwater tank, because you get back to the fundamentals. And people who keep quarantine tanks on a regular basis will be able to carry over some of that experience and not some of that knowledge base to their main display. So to get started, a quarantine tank should just be a basic aquarium. You don't want a huge tank. You want a smaller volume aquarium that's just gonna make it a lot easier to manage. It's going to concentrate the food closer to the fish, so you have a lot less uneaten food. And even if you're using something like a 20 or 29 gallon tank, you don't have to fill it all the way. There's no rule that says you have to fill the tank all the way. So for me, a great basic quarantine tank, it's gonna be your standard 10 gallon aquarium that you can get anywhere, used or new, for pretty cheap. And you don't want a tank that's too old with really, really crummy glass, because you need to see what's happening inside the tank for a number of reasons. All right, so moving along, you want some kind of water motion. You don't necessarily need to filter everything out of the water so much as you need to just oxygenate the water and make sure to circulate the water around, so that you can make sure to mix up any medication you might put in the tank. It's really good for fish health just to have some general motion. And also to distribute the food towards the fish, and you know, make sure to kind of spread out their waste so that a biological filter can take care of things. So for this tank, I'm just using a basic Seachem tidal filter, tidal power filter, a little hang on the back filter, but you can use really anything will work. What else? Okay, so the next most important thing is gonna be a heater, right? You need to keep an appropriate and stable water temperature. So again, a lot of different heaters will work for the job. It's kind of important to set these tanks up a few days before you know that you're gonna need them, so that the water temperature can stabilize. But in the same note, you really want a nice big thermometer that's gonna be in your face, so you can see what the temperature is at. So for quarantine tanks, I generally like to use really big, easy to see display, so that I don't have to come in and squint and add some tiny little stick-on thermometer, and I know what the temperature is at. So Something to keep in mind about temperature is that a lower temperature is going to make the biological filter process a little bit slower. It's going to reduce the reproductive rate of parasites. And a higher temperature can actually stimulate the metabolism of the fish, encouraging them to feed. Okay, so one thing that's actually not really mentioned that often for a quarantine tank is using a light. Hypothetically, the tank doesn't need a light, the fish doesn't need a light, you don't need a light. But I feel like it's pretty important to even have just any basic LED light. This is just a small USB jobby that I have over here for a number of reasons. When fish are in quarantine, you really need to see what they're up to. You need to see the quality of the slime coat on their skin, make sure there's no parasites. You want to observe their breathing rate, that's a really important one. Observe their bellies, make sure that they're eating food. Generally be familiar with the behavior of the fish in your quarantine system to know if they're doing well or if they're not doing well. And the other reason for some light is so the fish can actually see the food that you're trying to offer them. It's really important for you to be able to see what's happening in the tank, because if any diseases arise, you want to catch those as early as possible before they result in some secondary problems for the quarantined fish. So having a decent light is going to help you catch stuff the first few spots of Vic, whereas if you don't have a light, it might take 2 or 3 days for it to be really obvious that there's something wrong with your fish. So definitely consider a basic light on your aquarium. It's a big no-no to have any sand in the aquarium, and in the same vein, I really would advise against using any kind of live rock as well, because those are the kind of things where parasites can hide and they just don't really help anything. So instead, you do want to make your fish, your new wild fish, comfortable. So this is where actually plastic plants really come in handy, resin decorations. I am particularly fond of using biomedia. This is the Brightwell Export Bio Bricks and Bio Cubes. Got them arranged into a nice little shelf area. So this is a huge amount of biomedia for this tank. So I like to use that instead of sand or rock. It's just a lot easier to keep the parasites from installing themselves in the pores of your sand or your rock. So the common question I'll get is, what about wrasses? First of all, I am not a wrasse guy. I do not have a soft spot in my heart for wrasses. So if they need coddling and special attention, they're not going to get it from me. But if you're a wrasse lover and you want to quarantine your wrasse, you might consider just setting up a small tray, maybe with some heavy plastic beads that they can dive into. So we're talking about like razor wrasses and some of the bigger wrasses that like to hide in the sand. But in my experience, they're actually just fine hiding under something. It doesn't have to be sand. So no sand, no rock in your quarantine tank. This is very well established and agreed upon for quarantining procedures. In this tank, I have a ton of biomedia in the Brightwell Export Bricks. The thing is, these have been cycling since last year, using basically a pure ammonia source. So this is the ammonium chloride from Dr. Tim's. The thing is, there's a big difference between giving your biological filter a super pure, uncut source of ammonia versus kind of the organics soup that happens when you start feeding the fish and the fish start excreting nitrogenous waste and some of the food goes uneaten and breaks down. So we use ammonia and nitrite. Those are the main things we want to manage and handle, but there's some other organics byproducts that ammonia cycled biomedia was not going to handle alone. So even if you have a cycled tank, you want to have some kind of bacterial booster. So this is a really good one from Brightwell, the Microbacter 7. I don't really dose it per se. Just a couple days in, this tank got a little bit cloudy, so I just gave it a small glug. The next day I gave another glug, and that really helped to clarify the water in just a couple days, because like I said, this biomedia has been cycled for almost a year, but it's only gotten pure uncut ammonia, so this is the first time it's been exposed to real fish. Even if you have a cycled quarantine tank, You do not want to take for granted that it is cycled and cycling. So two really important things, one more than the other, is to be able to test the ammonia. So this is the ammonia alert right here from Seachem, one of the best products, still nothing like it. I really love it. Any kind of new reef tank or fish tank should have one of those for the first year, because that's how long those things last. And after that, you're probably almost never going to have an ammonia problem. So use the ammonia alert to indicate any kind of spikes in ammonia. And then something that is maybe a little less common is the test strips. So there's no nitrite equivalent of the ammonia alert. And so the second part of the nitrogenous cycle is nitrite. So you can dip these in and get a quick, you know, yes or no reading, is there nitrite in there? So I don't really use the ammo alert and this to determine how much ammonia or how much nitrite is in the aquarium. I just, for me, it's just a yes or no. Is there ammonia? Is there nitrite? And that's what I use those two basic tests for. So like I said in the beginning of this video, a quarantine tank is a lot more about acclimation and conditioning the fish. Just like all living things, just like us, when we are healthy, our immune system can handle a lot of adverse parasites and infections. So having a quarantine tank is a really important place to acclimate your fish to aquarium life, condition them to eating aquarium foods, whatever those may be. And so I would say it's like 80% conditioning really, and only 20% parasite management. How long to quarantine your fish? That really depends. I always go like way over, because I have a lot of tanks to play with, so I'm never in a super big rush. I think the generally agreed upon time period is a minimum of 14 days. 21 days, I think, is a sweet spot to make sure that ich spores have gone through their entire life cycle. 30 days is gonna, you know, push you beyond the mark, just to make sure you've kind of, you know, avoided any kind of pests or parasites. And there's nothing wrong with taking a little bit further. I don't really want this video to go into really hardcore pest and parasite management, because that's I'm only this much comfortable with it, you know. And so there's three basic lines of treatment that I want to tell you about, and if you want to, if you feel the need to use those, I really recommend you do more research on each of them. So as a foundation, as a baseline, a quarantine tank for saltwater fish really should be hypo-saline. This means we're dropping the salinity. Fish spend a lot of energy managing their salt and water concentration inside their body and inside their tissues at full strength seawater. So if you drop the salinity to a reasonable amount, the fish has to work a lot less just to manage its osmotic balance, and it has more energy for its immune system to fight off any potential pests or parasites or what have you. So I like to aim for a salinity of about 23 to 27 parts per thousand, and this equates to about 1.016 to 1.020 specific gravity, 1.01718, or about 23 to 25 parts per thousand is kind of the sweet spot. Virtually all fish can just take it right away. If you take it a little bit further than that, a little bit lower than that, you really can take it on a case by case depending on the fish that you're working with. And one really, really cool tool for doing this, for testing your salinity, is this Hanna salinity meter. We're not doing research with this, but it will give you, you know, pretty basic measurement of the salinity. So I think in here it's going to be 26, 23, and it's going to be 26 parts per thousand. And it's cool because it also has a secondary temperature readout, so you can double check and make sure that your thermometer is double checking your heater. So the Hanna salinity tester is a really, really good one. Hyposalinity should be kind of like your first line of defense for changing the water chemistry to help your fish fight off any potential pests or parasites. But then the most common pest or parasite that we have to deal with is gonna be ich. And for that, you wanna use, some copper. So Cupramine is probably the most popular copper solution in the world of saltwater aquariums for treating pests and parasites. This is going to be primarily used for ich. Be mindful that certain wrasses and certain tangs may develop problems over time if you have too high a concentration or you keep them in copper for too long. So you want to make sure you have a proper copper test kit and keep the concentration about 0.25 parts per million. So just a quarter part per million. So this is going to be probably 90% of what people have to deal with and have to treat with is going to be ick. And you're going to do that with the copper. Next up, some of the larger fish, especially angelfish and some butterfly fish, they almost always get like one fluke. And one fluke is not a big deal. You can give them a freshwater dip at the same temperature and the same pH, just 1 or 2 minutes. Will weaken the fluke and you can kind of baste it off of almost always on their eye. That's where you'll see it. Again, you want to have some light and clear water and a clear tank so you can catch it early before it turns into a bacterial infection. But so some of the better stores that really do know how to quarantine fish, they'll probably use a broad spectrum external parasite chemical or medicine like praziquantel. Prazipro is the common name for the medicine that we use in our aquariums. So this can be a lot more effective for for external parasites, especially flukes that might be on the body and it might be in the gills. So if your fish is breathing fast, abnormally fast, and otherwise looks good, there's a good chance it might have some flukes inside of its gills. And so treatment with praziquantel or Prazipro is advised. And then probably the last line of treatment, of major treatment, is going to be for bacterial infections. My go-to is Canaplex and Neoplex. I do not follow the directions. I do a double dose of this every other day and do a water change in between before I redose it. And this is particularly effective for treating clownfish disease. So when I get any kind of wild clownfish, they're gonna go through my wild clownfish Canaplex and Neoplex protocol, and it works every single time to clean them up. So, but hopefully you will get some clean fish, put them in your quarantine tank, and they're gonna do just fine. They're gonna do great, and you won't have to come up with any treatment. So there's really not that many parts to a quarantine tank. If you put all these pieces together, they will do super duper well. And this particular quarantine tank I set up for my first batch of Ventralis antheus that I got from Quality Marine. So I want to thank Quality Marine for sending me the first population of Ventralis antheus that I've gotten here at the studio. I'm going to try to collect some from the Marshall Islands because they're different, from the Philippines because they're different. Maybe if I'm lucky, I can also get some from the Coral Sea. So these fish are a little bit deeper water, a little bit cooler water, and as you can see, they are hiding on the other side of the aquarium because I've never sat here next to them. And I've been feeding them mostly the frozen calanus. They're doing pretty good. Let me see if I can hey buddies. Yeah, they're really doing well. I have not fed them yet today. And one thing that really kind of ties into the conditioning aspect is feeding fish rich food. You guys know I am not a huge proponent of frozen food. In fact, I'm almost against it. But this is a good time to condition your fish, fatten them up, get them started eating anything because the fish have been purged for a long time. Same with these guys. And these are basically like hummingbirds. They need to be fed a lot. So I started out feeding the Ventralis antheus some frozen calanus, and that was great, but I was really kind of burning through the calanus pretty quickly. So I have this freeze-dried calanus here from two little fishies, and what's really cool is instead of hydrating it with straight water, I was using the amino omega, this is basically like a broad spectrum amino acid and vitamin supplement for fish. So I soaked all of that into basically a solution here, and I think it's gonna last me another day or two. I freeze it every day so I can make 2 to 3 days worth of this stuff. Let's see if they'll eat on camera. I know they're not used to having me here, but every time they take a bite of this, they get a big old mouthful of the amino omega vitamin supplements going straight to their gut. It's gotta be really, really good for them. Let's see if they're hungry, because I have not fed them yet today, but they have a lot of light on them, and I'm not usually sitting right next to the tank, so I'm just gonna have to watch the footage and see if they're eating. Oh yeah, there you go. There you go. So once again, I want to thank Quality Marine for sending these Ventralis antheus along. They're doing super good. It's one of my super duper favorite fish. They are basically being kind of like pre-quarantined in here before they go in the main system over there. And I really only have this tank up for, it's been about a week. And right after this video, I'm gonna tear it down and put the fish in the main system. Kind of wanted to like pre-treat them before they went into my general quarantine system population. All right, I think that basically sums up what you need to know to have a quarantine tank. Basic tank, some movement, proper temperature, reduced salinity, a calm environment for your fish to chill in. Just kind of pay attention. Oh boy, actually I forgot one. It's not just your fish that can introduce pests and parasites to your reef tank. And the depressing part is, if you really want to keep all pests and parasites, especially ick, out of your reef tank, you should quarantine your corals, your invertebrates, everything. Everything has to be isolated, because an ick spore can ride on any tiny little piece of shell, even a frag, man. I've gotten it. I've had it. I've had ick come into a reef tank from just a frag. It's very rare, so I don't want to scare you away from buying frags, but just know that it's probably going to be better just to have a little nano tank to put your frags in, even just for a few days before introducing them to your main tank. So there are definitely some cases where people have quarantined the heck out of their fish very, very well, but then they will get some dirty frag or some dirty corals from some store or somebody who's keeping their tank or their corals with a lot of fish at the same time. And if that's the case, it's possible that your frags and stuff can bring in ick. So it's not fun. It's actually kind of depressing to think about. But if you quarantine your fish and they're happy and they're healthy, it's very unlikely that they're going to show any signs of ick or other parasites, or let alone succumb to them. So I know there's a lot of information for you guys. This is my penultimate video on quarantining fish. There's really nothing else to do but to do it and learn and get more experience. So if you have any questions, specific questions that are not answered or addressed in this video, please post those down below. Share this video with some of your clubs, your Facebook pages, because I feel like this is a topic that people really, really should know. It's really easy to set up a quarantine tank. And if people, you guys know how many reefers you've heard of complain that they're going through these disease problems. And it's really easy to avoid. Set up a small basic quarantine tank. I hope you enjoyed this video. Help me get the word out that people should be quarantining their fish and stuff. So if you enjoyed this video, give it a like. I'm not gonna let another 2 weeks go by before the next video comes out. So thanks for being patient with me. And I will aim to have a lot more entertaining and eye candy material for the next video. So I will catch you guys on the next one. Bye.